Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Michael Oren.
Hello. Good evening, or as they say in Palo Alto, shalom. How are you? So this is the book. It's called Ally. I had to come up with, I had to write a 400-page book in 1 year, taking off 50 days for a war last summer. And when it was all over, I had to come up with a title. You don't think about this. What are you going to call this book? And I had this strange notion that it was going to be one word with two syllables. I don't know why. And then one night I stood up next to my wife and I said, it's called Ally. And she said, well, there's going to be a problem with that because someone's going to look at it and it's going to say, Ally. I don't want to embarrass, but one of these evenings I was actually introduced as the author of Ally. No kidding. My wife's name is Sally. She says, someone's going to think that you forgot the S. Ally. Ally in English is one of the most beautiful words. Think about it. Think about ally almost never has a negative connotation. You can be a partner in crime, but never an ally in crime. And in the Hebrew language, too, ally is one of those beautiful phrases. Ben Brit. Ben Brit, the son of a covenant. Bnei Brit, sons of a covenant. And it evokes the special relationship between the Jewish people and God. The United States and Israel have a special relationship. I want you to think about this. They have a spiritual tie that goes way back before 1948 in Israel's creation. It goes back before 1776 in America's creation. It goes back to the Puritans who came to the east coast of this country back at the beginning of the 17th century, and the Puritans thought of themselves as the new Israel. And they had a deep connection to the old Israel, the Jews. They inherited a new promised land. They had a deep connection to the old promised land, the land of Israel. And they concluded that to be good Americans, to be good Christians as well, it was their duty to get those old Jews back home and create a state in their ancient land. So you had Americans like John Adams, Abraham Lincoln, Woodrow Wilson, and of course Harry Truman, who were what you would call today Zionists. They believed that the Jewish people had a right to create a national homeland in their ancestral land, the land of Israel. So there's a spiritual tie. Today, America remains the most religiously observant of any modernized country. And more people go to church in this country than any other industrialized country. And people read their Bible, and they see that God made certain promises to the Jews. God doesn't lie. I would go up to the Hill at least twice a week in my job as ambassador, and it was not rare, not infrequently. I would go into the office of some congressman from West Texas whose district was five times as large as the state of Israel, probably didn't have a lot of Jewish constituents, and he had the Bible opened on his desk, open to the chapter in Genesis where it says, God says, those who bless my people shall be blessed. He'd point to that and say, I believe in that. How much aid do you want for Iron Dome? Just like that. So you had a spiritual connection. 1948, the state of Israel comes into being not just as a Jewish state, but also as a democratic state. We're part of that ever-shortening list, believe it or not, of democratic countries in the world. We're part of a very exclusive club in Israel of countries that have never known a second of non-democratic governance. We're up there with the United States, Canada, New Zealand, Australia, very small group. And the fact that that Israel has never known a second of non-democratic governments, in spite of the fact that it's never known a second of peace, puts us in a completely unique category. Completely scary. So the question of this joint feeling of shared democratic values adds another layer of connectedness between the United States and Israel. What there was not was a strategic alliance. And that is of relatively recent provenance. It's only after the 1967 war, which Israel fought with French arms, that American policymakers woke up and said, whoa, there's this powerhouse of a country out in the Middle East that just defeated several Soviet-backed armies. We should be allied with that country. And thus was born the U.S.-Israel military alliance, which has burgeoned into so many different areas. It's weapons development, anti-ballistic systems, joint training, intelligence sharing, at just about the highest level you'll find anywhere in the world. So you're talking about two countries that are linked in ways that the United States has not been linked with many countries. America has a very close relationship with Italy, but does it have a spiritual tie with Italy? It has a close tie with certain other, even Middle Eastern countries, Saudi Arabia. Does it have shared democratic values with Saudi Arabia? No. And doesn't necessarily have military ties as well. So it's that unique combination of these three areas that make this connection so, so tight. In many ways, the United States and Israel are ultimate allies. And yet, that relationship has divides, hence the subtitle of the book, Across the American-Israel Divides. What are we divided about? We are divided about the peace process. We are divided about the issue of settlements, which began not with Barack Obama. It started with Lyndon Johnson in 1967. We are divided about the status of the city of Jerusalem, Israel's capital, and that's a division that goes back to Harry Truman. Harry Truman did not recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital. He put the American embassy in Tel Aviv, and where it remains to this very day. So we have divides. We're divided over American weapon sales to Arab countries, and America sells billions of dollars to Arab countries. Many of them are not in an active state of war with Israel, but who knows who's going to be in charge of those countries 5 years from now? We're in a state of extreme flux in the Middle East. Who knows into whose hands these weapons may fall? So we're divided on that. And most recently, most poignantly, today, we are divided over the Iranian nuclear deal that's on the table. And that is a profound, profound divide between us. Now, I always thought of myself on a personal level on a sort of being the bridge between these divides. I grew up on the other side of this country in New Jersey. Yay. Somebody invariably claps. Come on, someone's got to clap for New Jersey, please. I mean, thank you, thank you. I always said, when I was ambassador, I used to say I spent more time defending the state of New Jersey than I did defending the state of Israel. Senator Menendez didn't think that was funny. I told her, just looked at me. I grew up as a typical American background. I was a klutzy, fat, uncoordinated, dyslexic kid, failing out of school, failing out of Hebrew school. But I had a lot of dreams, and funny thing is I dreamt about being a writer, which was pretty funny because I couldn't spell. I dreamt of someday moving to Israel, which was did funny because I was expelled from Hebrew school. I loved America. I'm unabashedly sentimental about America. I get choked up the Star Spangled Banner. My kids make fun of me. They roll their eyes. I loved everything that this country imparted to me. I'm sitting here with some of my family here, the Steins, Barry. They know my father very well. My father was a career officer in the U.S. military, landed on Normandy, fought away through World War II. And I grew up with his values. And I internalized them, but I always thought of myself as someone who deeply loved the Jewish people, Jewish history. I thought myself incalculably lucky to be alive at a time when there was a sovereign Jewish state. And I thought of myself, I was going to move to Israel, I was going to be a soldier, which was funnier still because I couldn't run, never mind run with a gun. I thought I'd meet the girl of my dreams, which is funny too because I couldn't get a date to the junior prom. And there I had these dreams. But in a rather typical American fashion, I lived out my dreams. I taught myself how to spell, became a writer and historian. I went off to kibbutz to work on kibbutz and later went into the paratroopers in the military in Israel. Met the girl of my dreams, Sally from San Francisco, who actually didn't go to the junior prom because it wasn't cool enough. She was busy playing Frisbee with Jerry Garcia. You'll read about it. It's a story. And to fulfill my dreams, I had a dream of also what I was going to be when I was grow up. When I was 15, still in New Jersey, I was taking a trip to Washington, D.C. with my Zionist youth movement, and I had a chance to meet Israel's ambassador to the United States, and his name was Yitzhak Rabin. Back then, I shook his hand, and I thought, that's what I want to be when I grow up. I want to be Israel's ambassador to the United States. And I always had that dream. I had that dream as I was living my Israeli life, and some of that dream had its nightmarish qualities. So I fought in a couple of wars. Our son, eldest son, was wounded in combat. Sally's sister was killed in a suicide bomber. I got to work with Yitzhak Rabin, but only a few months after I started working with him, he was assassinated by a Jewish extremist. Some tough. But we made a life, and then in 2009, I got to fulfill the ultimate dream. The newly elected Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, though I wasn't a member of his party, nor a close associate. Knew that I had specialized in U.S.-American relations for about 30 years, thought I would be a good ambassador, tried me out. There were several other candidates, and chose me. So in 2009, I went to Washington, D.C. to fulfill that role that I was so inspired to fulfill by Yitzhak Rabin, oh boy, about 40 years before that. And I came at a very challenging time, a challenging time for the United States. Remember, this is ancient history, 2009. America is in the depths of an economic crisis, the deepest since the Great Depression of the 1930s, deep political polarization in the United States between Republicans and Democrats. Nobody's talking to anybody. Remember this? It's still going on today to a large extent. There is war weariness after two traumatic wars in the region. And America's not in a very good shape either, but the Middle East is even worse shape. The entire Middle East is about to come apart. We didn't know it in 2009, but the whole Middle East, as we had known it for the previous century, was going to unravel. Egypt would have not one but two violent revolutions. Syria and Iraq as states would cease to exist. The peace process was dead in the water. The previous Israeli government under Ehud Olmert had offered Mahmoud Abbas, the president of the Palestinian Authority, a complete Palestinian state deal. All of Gaza, almost the entire West Bank, half of Jerusalem, and Mahmoud Abbas had walked away, and he hadn't come back to the table. He refused to negotiate with us. This is the situation we inherited. And just at this fateful juncture in our histories, you have these two individuals. On one hand, Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister of Israel, and the newly elected President of the United States, Barack Obama. And rarely at such fateful junctures could you have had two more mismatched leaders. Totally mismatched leaders. Think about Netanyahu on one hand. Here's a guy who had been a commander in Israel's Delta Force, Seret Matkal, some of you know, Israel's Delta Force. He was an MIT graduate, BA, MA, studied at Harvard as well. He had about 20 years of legislative experience, had been Israel's ambassador to the UN, had been the deputy ambassador in Washington, a successful foreign minister, a successful finance minister, once a prime minister, a lot of experience, but a Benjamin Netanyahu, who was not exactly revered in the world and faced a tremendous amount of opposition at home. And you compare him to Barack Obama, who did not have Netanyahu's experience in all these different areas, but he was an icon in 2009 in the entire world, and particularly in the United States. I mean, the New York Times made a coffee table book about him. It was amazing. I still have two copies of that coffee table book. And that's when you think about it, it's out of the box. The New York Times doesn't often make coffee table books about politicians. And so these two men, in addition to their great disparity in popularity and experience, have very different worldviews. And Netanyahu, you should know, he's the person, he hates political correctness. He never uses the word paradigm for some reason. He hates the word paradigm. I'm letting you into state secrets here. He is the anti-rock star. When he moved into his office as prime minister early in 2009, the first thing he did was to hang a big portrait of Winston Churchill right over his right shoulder in his office so that Winston Churchill would always look down upon him. Okay? Now compare that to Barack Obama, who in 2009 certainly is the rock star. He's the epitome of political correctness. And one of the first things he does when he goes into the Oval Office is to remove a bust of Winston Churchill. Okay? Are you getting... This is like a match made in heaven here between these two. And in addition to all that, there are deep ideological differences. And I had to explore these differences. I had to get into Obama's head, as we used to say. There's a chapter in the book where I talk Obama 101. It's a course that I gave myself where I use my historian skills and try to see the world through the president's eyes. And what I saw was a president who put a tremendous emphasis on outreach to what he called the Muslim world, a heavy emphasis on international institutions such as the UN, which aren't so friendly to Israel all the time, a less prominent leadership role for America in the world, a collegial approach to world affairs. America's not going to be the policeman anymore, a recoiling from the use of military power. I think one of the most memorable lines I've ever heard the president say was, whether we like it or not, America is the world's leading military power. It's a rather extraordinary line. You may not have heard that from the lips of someone like, you know, Bill Clinton or John Kennedy. It's really showing a different type of worldview. It's a worldview I knew from having taught in various universities, but it was a worldview. And it was Israel's responsibility to somehow accommodate that. And I saw my role, my role is to figure out who is this new American leadership, where is it going, and can we adapt ourselves to it to the degree that was consonant with our fundamental security issues. Two of the greatest challenges I faced as ambassador was on the part of a decision by the administration to distance itself from two long-standing principles in the U.S.-Israel relationship that existed pretty much from the middle Reagan years of 1985. The two principles were no surprises and no daylight. What does this mean? No surprises means if the United States is going to make a major pronouncement on Middle East policy that's going to impact Israel's security, then Israel will have a chance to look at the statement before it's given and to submit our comments. A good example would be the 2002 roadmap of George Bush. Prime Minister Ariel Sharon had a chance to look at that first and submit his comments. No surprises. And the second was no daylight. No daylight means we can have our differences over settlements, over Jerusalem, but we should not air those differences publicly because our enemies, our common enemies, will insinuate themselves between us and conclude that they can exploit those differences between us. So there was actually a conscious decision by the administration to change this basis of the relationship. There were other parts that the administration very much preserved, particularly the security cooperation, which reached an all-time high during the Obama years. But on the diplomatic level, there were great divides between us, which had security ramifications. I was present at the first meeting between Obama and Netanyahu in May of 2009. They had about 12 meetings altogether. I've been at all of them. And that sort of set the stage. It wasn't as if there was personal friction, but the president surprised the prime minister by demanding that he freeze all settlement activity, building activity in the West Bank, but also in Jerusalem. And this was problematic because the prime minister of Israel actually has no authority to freeze settlement building in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is sovereign Israeli territory and has been since the summer of 1967, when it was formally annexed, formally reunited by Israeli law. So the prime minister has no more authority to freeze Jewish building in that city than, say, the president has the power to freeze building in Palo Alto. So it was a very difficult demand, but it was made very publicly. So there was daylight. There was a surprise, and there was daylight. The prime minister was also surprised to hear that the president demanded that Netanyahu come out and support the two-state solution, which he had not done yet. He was the head of the Likud party, which did not accept the two-state solution. So that was a surprise, and it was also made very, very publicly. Big surprise. Now, my job, again, was to tell the prime minister how I think we can deal with this new situation, and my approach wasn't always the accepted approach, and I'll be very frank with you, and I discussed this very openly. My position was we should choose our battles very carefully. I use the example of Muhammad Ali's strategy of rope-a-dope. You know, if someone wants to hit you, you take the punches, but when you need to stick your heels in on an example on an issue like Iran, you can do that. And so sometimes the prime minister was very accommodating. He came out and became the first Likud leader to accept the two-state solution. He was the first Israeli leader to freeze new settlement building in the West Bank. We froze it for 10 months from the end of 2009 to about mid-2010. Unfortunately, he didn't get a lot of credit for this from the administration, and it didn't bring the Palestinians back to the negotiating table. And so the demand for settlement freeze, for freeze in Jerusalem, remained very, very public, and the notion of no surprises and no daylight also remained a major challenge for us, a particular challenge for me. On May 18th, 2011, I was in the White House, and the next day the president was set to give a major speech about the Arab Spring, which had broken out the previous January, February. And at the White House, they assured me there would be no component in the speech that related to Israel-Palestine. And the speech the next day, May 19th, dealt mostly with Israel-Palestine. It was a speech in which the president said that the basis for negotiations between Israelis and the Palestinians should be the 1967 borders with swaps. Now, this would seem sort of logical, but according to the very intricate terms of reference, TOR, that we had worked out with Secretary of State Clinton, and I have that terms of reference engraved on my soul, you should know, it says the following. The United States believes that through good faith negotiations, it can reconcile the Israeli goal of an independent Jewish state with secure and recognized borders with the Palestinian goal of an independent state based on the 67 borders with mutually agreed swaps. So what the president did in sort of one fell swoop was to move what had been a Palestinian goal to being an American goal. Now, that was problematic. We learned to deal with it, but he did it without telling us. And that was the surprises, and that was the daylight. Now, nobody had a monopoly over mistakes. We made mistakes. I got great shock for you. I made mistakes. And we also surprised the administration. I accompanied Vice President Biden on his first trip into Israel, and we surprised him. We announced a project in East Jerusalem, an Israeli building project. Next time Prime Minister Netanyahu met with Biden was in New Orleans, and we again surprised him by making an announcement. But both times, the Prime Minister was at least as surprised as the Vice President, and he apologized. This wasn't a matter of policy. Someone in mid-level in the Interior Ministry made these announcements, very embarrassing, but you know, we got past it. And later, now when I was no longer ambassador, last March, the Prime Minister surprised the President by showing up in Congress, you may recall, and giving a speech there without a surprise. I can't have any responsibility for that. But as a member of a different political party, I was critical of the move, particularly for that reason. We have to preserve these two principles of no surprises and no daylight because they're crucial for our alliance. Now, I don't want to give you the impression that it was all about strains, all about conflict. There were times when President Obama was there and when we really needed him. December 2010. Exactly, I think it was December 5th, 2010. I am opposite the White House about to go into the Hanukkah party. Very important event in Washington. It's a very surreal event in Washington. I got to because the White House has its Christmas decorations up already. And you have all these Jews in various states of headwear, including Orthodox Jews, and they're sort of munching latkes around all the mistletoe and Christmas trees. You can't make this up. And as I'm walking in, this is no joke, I get a call from the Prime Minister using a tone which I have never heard before and don't hope to hear again. Panic. A major fire has just broken out in Israel's largest forest, the Carmel mountain range. It's already killed 26 people within a matter of minutes. Israel has no retardant. That's that orange stuff that you throw out of planes that snipes out fires. We have no extinguishing aircraft. And the fire is descending on Haifa, and there's nothing to stop it. And the Prime Minister pleads with me, go into the President, urge him to give us help. We need help immediately. So I went into the White House. I ran into Susan Scher, who is the First Lady's Chief of Staff. And again, you can't make this up. She went to my high school in New Jersey, and her father plays tennis with my father. And I said, listen, I need to see the President right away. I got an emergency. Come on, Ryan. Go see the President. I said, Mr. President, Israel needs you. This disastrous fire is consuming a chunk of the northern part of the country. We have nothing to stop it. We need retardant. We need planes. And the President turned to his chief aide, Reggie Love, great basketball player. He said, Reggie, get Michael everything he needs. And we set up an emergency room in the emergency headquarters in the NSC that night in the West Wing. We're there all night long. Israel, the U.S. Army scrubbed its warehouses in Western Europe to get us that retardant. America has 11 firefighting planes. We got 8 of them. America sent these commandos, they're called hotspots, who parachute behind fires and put them out. They left Boise, Idaho that night and went through Newark and arrived in Israel and tried to participate in extinguishing the fire. And I tell you, I'm very sentimental. Even when I tell this story today, I get choked up about it. So it wasn't, you know, unequivocally, it wasn't uninterruptedly tension. But the notion of that the two countries had had this historic alliance and it was built on a certain level of trust, that greatly eroded over the course of the year. And it came to the fore in the form of the disagreement, the very deep divide over the Iranian nuclear program. And just a word about the program. Understand where Israel's coming at here. The Iranian nuclear program represents, from Israel's perspective, not one but several existential threats. Now, there's the obvious threat. If they get a nuclear weapon, they get a warhead. And according to the deal, the best of our knowledge that we have on the table, they could break out and get that warhead in something, at most a year, as little as 1 month. And they already have a fleet of intercontinental ballistic missiles that can deliver that warhead to Israel, hit any city. And we're a one-bomb country, according to a former moderate prime minister of president of Iran, Rafsanjani. We're a one-bomb country. We're the size of New Jersey. And that's just the beginning of the existential threat. Iran is the world's leading state sponsor of terror. And Iran and its proxies have killed more Americans than any other entity other than Al-Qaeda. And they are actively seeking to destroy Jews and Israelis around the world. On five continents and dozens of cities around the world, they tried to blow up my embassy in Washington, D.C. Read about it. And they are terrorists and terrorist sponsors. If they get nuclear military capabilities, so will the terrorists. And we won't have to worry about an ICBM, have to worry about a ship container coming into Haifa Harbor or, you know, into Oakland. Gotcha. And it's very, very dangerous for us. And once Iran gets the bomb, Egypt gets the bomb, Saudi Arabia gets the bomb, Turkey gets the bomb, everybody gets the bomb, and Israel finds itself living in a profoundly unstable nuclear neighborhood. So it's a real problem for us. Now, we have structural differences in the United States. I'm going to tell you something that's going to be a huge shock. America's a big country. It's far away from the Middle East. It's not threatened with national annihilation by the Iranians. You have very big military capabilities. We are a small country. We are in Iran's backyard. We are threatened with genocide by the Iranian regime. And we're a pretty strong country. Our army is twice as big as the French and British army combined, but we don't have strategic bombers. We don't have aircraft carriers. So our margin for error on Iran is exactly zero. Exactly zero. And we have ideological differences. The president has said that Iran is a rational country, even though it's anti-Semitic. It works on a cost-benefit analysis. You can reach an agreement with it. We think Iran is an irrational country. And when it says it wants to destroy us, it means it. So we have zero margin for error. And this is a deep divide. It's a deep divide that even if we restore the principles of no surprise, that's going to remain. But we have to work to replenish and restore and strengthen this alliance. At the end of the day, Israel has no substitute for the United States of America as its ultimate ally. No one's going to provide us with $4 billion a year in aid. No one's going to stick by us in international organizations. No one's going to be the beacon of democratic inspiration for us around the world. And frankly, the United States doesn't have much alternative to the state of Israel either. We're the only country in the Middle East, and not only in the Middle East, that is technologically, scientifically, militarily robust, that has never known that second of non-democratic rule, that is unabashedly, unreservedly pro-American. You never see an American flag burnt in the streets of Tel Aviv. And believe me, in the Middle East, that's a pretty rare sight today, not to see American flags burnt. So we have each other. We have each other, and we have to work to replenish this relationship because it is very precious indeed. I believe emphatically, unreservedly, that the U.S.-Israel alliance not only redounds to the security of both countries, but it is essential for retaining what remains of any stability in the Middle East, and it is essential for the well-being of the entire world because the entire world is watching us. We are the litmus for America's relationship with the world, whether you're French or you're Spanish, you're jihadist or Japanese, everyone's watching our alliance, which is why I wrote this book. It's why I brought it out now in this season, in June, when people don't read a lot of serious books. They're already thinking about beach books. This is the season where you bring out Jaws. I told Random House, we'll change the name of the book. We'll call it Jews. All right? It's a testament. It's a confession. It's a cry for the heart for everyone to stop and feel the gratitude that I feel and have always felt for being a part of the land of my father to the land of my forefathers, the land of my birth to the land of my birthright, the U.S.-Israel alliance ally. Thank you. Good enough. Steven.
Thank you very much, Michael Oren, for your remarks. My name is Steven Saum, and I'm the editor of Santa Clara Magazine. But more important, I'm the moderator for your questions tonight. So please continue to send those up while we engage right off the bat here. Today was supposed to be the signing of an agreement with Iran originally. So had that happened, or if it happens a week from now, what changes?
Well, first of all, I say let's address the question why it didn't happen today. And, call it a Cassandra complex, but if you study the Middle East long enough, you're not surprised that much. I had long felt that the Iranians wouldn't sign today for the very simple reason that since 2009, the administration has said that the window for diplomacy with Iran would not remain permanently open. And it turns out that it's actually not a window. It's sort of more or less an aperture that doesn't close. So the Iranians have internalized that the longer they stay at the table, the more concessions they're going to get. And if I were their negotiator, I wouldn't sign today. I'd hold out a little longer. Why? What's the rush? The president made a statement this morning saying that there would, again, he said that the window for diplomacy would not remain open indefinitely, that he would walk away from the table. I hope he sticks by that, because I think that's what will bring about a better agreement. If this agreement is signed and we more or less know the parameters, and you should understand what would be a good deal from Israel's perspective. It's not as if we don't have a notion of what a good deal is. We do, and it has many different aspects, including the actual dismantling, not just the detaching from the plug of Iranian facilities and centrifuges, but it's also a deal that conditions the international recognition of an Iranian nuclear program to a change in Iran's behavior. It can't go on being the leading world sponsor of terror. It cannot try to and sometimes succeed in undermining pro-American governments in the world, and it has to stop seeking our destruction. I think that's a pretty basic demand, not too out of the ballpark. If a bad deal is signed, then Israel will have to recalculate. The prime minister has said, and I'm not his spokesman anymore, but he has said now twice publicly that if Israel has to stand alone, Israel will stand alone. And Israel has the right, it has the duty, and it has the capability to defend itself against Iran. I'm quiet, thank you.
So from a military option, whether that's Israel or the United States, so what does that look like? And what would the blowback be? Not just from Iran, but throughout the Middle East.
Well, I don't want to go there on this stage. Obviously, we're not going to disclose classified material here. But again, Israel has the right and the duty, and we also have to take into consideration that Iran has proxies. Iran's chief ally in the region is Hezbollah. Hezbollah has 100,000 rockets. That is more rockets than in the hands of NATO. I can't think of any other country in modern times that has faced a threat like that. Those rockets can hit every city in the state of Israel, including a lot. And all of our calculations have to take into account the possibility that Hezbollah is going to fire these things. They're not the Soviets who built up rocket arsenals in order not to use them. Hezbollah built up rocket arsenals. We've learned this from Hamas. They build them up to use them. And we have to cooperate very closely with our American allies in developing the systems that can intercept these rockets. You saw how Iron Dome worked very well last summer and saved not only hundreds of Israeli lives, but saved thousands of Palestinian lives, you should know. Because if hundreds of Israelis had been killed by those rockets, the IDF would have had to go into Gaza all the way, conquer Gaza. And it would have been disastrous for the Palestinians. We have to take that into consideration. We always have to recalculate and understand. We have learned, Stephen, we've now had four wars with terrorists in Gaza and in Lebanon. We know we cannot take these rockets out from the air. They can only be taken out from the ground. And that is a very complicated operation and a very costly one.
So this audience member says, can you compare the proposed agreement with Iran with the 1994 nuclear agreement with North Korea and how that turned out?
We do all the time, by the way. And it was our point of reference, and some of the same people were involved in negotiating this agreement, which didn't give us a lot of peace, knowing the same people. And if you look at some of the film clips of the way President Clinton back then described the agreement with North Korea, how it gave assurances that there would be intrusive inspections and restored international confidence in the North Korean nuclear program. Almost some of the same locutions, the same words were used in 1994 that are being used today, and we all know what happened. North Korea snuck out and became a nuclear-armed state. Now, here we get to a big difference. The President of the United States, President Obama, has said that Iran is not North Korea. Prime Minister Netanyahu has said that Iran is worse than 50 North Koreas. And from an Israeli perspective, the explanation for that is very simple. North Korea, as far as we know, is not a world sponsor of terror. North Korea is not threatening to wipe another country off the map and kill 8 million of its citizens. Iran is. And it's not a secular communist ideology. It is a radical jihadist ideology that is regnant in Iran. So it's, for our perspective, worse than 50 North Koreas.
So this person asks kind of a hopeful question. Is the emergent regional alliance of Israel, Egypt, Jordan, Saudi Arabia a reality or wishful thinking regarding the agreement that is the multilateral rather than bilateral?
And the answer to that question is yes. It's wishful thinking and it's reality. What does that mean? How can it be both at the same time? Let's start with the reality. Yes, we have found ourselves in a greater confluence of interest with the Gulf states, with Egypt, with Jordan, than at any time since Israel's creation in 1948. What, we both share common concerns, enemies for threats, the Iranian nuclear program, Muslim Brotherhood, ISIS. One of the painful paradoxes of the last few years is that the President of the United States, who set out to bring Israelis and Arabs closer together through peace, brought them closer together through common anxiety over his policies toward Iran. It's just a fact. And, I mean, last summer was the only time since 1967 where the United States was not involved in mediating an end to Israeli-Arab fighting, because both the Arab side and the Israeli side didn't like the American position, was to bring the Turks and the Qataris in because they were allies of Hamas. And the American position was that Qataris and Hamas could, Qataris and the Turks could communicate with Hamas better. Our position was we were communicating with Hamas perfectly fine through the Israeli Defense Forces. And we didn't want that type of mediation. So yes, they brought us closer together. So that, yes, we have this confluent interest, but the fantasy of it is I would not expect the Saudis to show up tomorrow at some negotiating table or some peace conference. I had a lot of experience with trying to get the Saudis to cooperate, even with symbolic measures on the peace process, and the Kuwaitis and other Emiratis. But they will support us behind the scenes quietly, like they did last summer. Just don't force them to sit around the table and they'll be fine.
So where does Russia fit in, this person wants to know, into the quagmire regarding the Syria situation with regards to Turkey and Jordan, no-fly zone, and how does Israel fit into the problem, I think specifically in Syria?
In Syria, we're talking about Syria or Russia? Russia, you know, diplomacy like outer space hates a vacuum. And when people perceive of a vacuum in diplomacy, other states will seek to fill it. So the United States has been withdrawing in one way or another from the Middle East. Everybody feels it. And other countries will rush in, whether it be the French now, who are about to put down a proposal at the Security Council on an Israeli-Palestinian peace plan, even the New Zealanders, the Russians. The Russians have rushed in and to fill a vacuum. And they have been reasserting what they regard as their backyard in the Mediterranean, standing up for Bashar al-Assad in Syria, threatening to sell advanced systems to various nefarious regimes around the world, like the Iranians. They're threatening to sell a very advanced anti-aircraft system, the S-300, to the Iranians, which is of grave concern to the State of Israel, and generally up to mischief in our area. Now, Israel, we were talking about this before backstage, Israel has an interesting relationship, complex relationship with Russia. More than once when I was in Washington, American officials would come to me and ask, okay, what are the Russians up to? Because what? If you go out into the streets of Israel, one out of every seven Israelis speaks Russian. And a lot of signs are in Russian. There's a Russian television station. We are one of Russia's biggest and most talented diasporas in the world. Really. Per capita, the Russians are off the charts. In terms of education, in terms of culture. Back in the late 80s, when the Russians, Jewish, were coming out, they used to say, what do you call a Russian Jew without a violin case? And the answer was, pianist, right? And very good. They've transformed Israeli society. So we were talking before how there's not a lot of sympathy for the Ukraine in Israel because our grandparents fled the Ukraine. It was the land of the pogroms, so understand that. So you put this all together. On one hand, we have this cultural affinity, this bond. I'm in Knesset now. There's discussions going on in Russian all over the Knesset. On the other hand, the Russians are supporting the Syrians, the Bashar Assad regime, which we don't like, threatening to sell these systems in the region, which we don't like. So it's a mixed bag with the Russians.
So actually, we were also talking backstage a little bit about your trip to the Soviet Union. You went there in the 1980s. Let's shift gears here a little bit.
The past.
Right. because this is in the book, and you also mentioned Russia's backyard, right? So that seems a natural segue into Ukraine. But can you talk about what you were doing in the Soviet Union in the 1980s?
Well, one of the things I think Jews today, whether they're in Israel or in the United States, we should generally be grateful. This is a moment for gratitude. With all the differences we face and sometimes the acrid debates we have over settlements, the peace process, over the Iranian nuclear issue, let's be grateful. We have these two extraordinary communities that are immensely pop, immensely successful. And every Jew in the world today is free. But when I was a younger person, not every Jew in the world was free. There were 3 million Jews behind the Soviet bloc who could be sent to labor, hard labor, for 10 years for studying Hebrew. Think about that. They could be sent to hard labor for wanting to immigrate to Israel. And they had these underground Zionist groups that struggled terribly. And the State of Israel took it upon itself to maintain constant contact with these groups at great risk. And I came out of the Israeli paratroopers. I still had 2 passports back then. And I had a combat background, and they fixed me up with someone else who had 2 passports who had a combat background. They said, would you go and work and make contact with the Zionist underground in the Soviet Ukraine, which is a particularly bad place. So how could I say no? My whole life had been about service, had been about Zionism. And so in the late winter of 1982, during the terrible Brezhnev period, I was sent out to the Ukraine. And it was not easy. I encountered the most courageous, intrepid people I'd ever met in my life. And they came from all different backgrounds. They were scientists and carpenters and mechanics. The head of the Zionist underground in Odessa was a 16-year-old girl who was 4'10" and who literally saved my life by throwing her body at a KGB thug who was going to hit me with a baseball bat and said, hit me first. Saved my life, really. And the first contact we had, I'll end this story because I'll get all caught up. I'll get sentimental again. The first contact, we had to memorize all of our contacts' names in Russian. You know Russian? I don't. And try memorizing names in Russian when you don't know Russian, including their address and their phone numbers. The easiest one I had to memorize was was a gentleman by the name of Yuli Edelstein, who happened to share the same last name as my fiance and later wife, Sally Edelstein. And so his name just stuck with me. He was a 23-year-old college student thrown out of college. He was cleaning floors, cleaning buildings. And when we first arrived in Moscow, I went to an abandoned train platform. I remembered his number. I called him. He showed up, handsome, brave kid. And he was the person who said, you know, don't be afraid. Don't show them any fear to the KGB. Don't let them have an inch. Last March, I won my election for Knesset. I was sworn in for Knesset. My first vote in Knesset was to push the button that says yes. And I voted to renominate Yuli Edelstein as the Speaker of Israel's Knesset. How about that? Huh? You can't make that up. You can't make that up. And we see each other and we just get all teary-eyed.
Well, so since you mentioned the Knesset, so can you talk about your transition of going from your service as a diplomat to being elected to the Knesset and not as a part of Likud?
I've gone through a lot of transformations in my life. Citizen, first of all, American to Israeli, citizen to soldier, soldier to diplomat, not easy. Diplomat back to citizen, which is not easy again, because who are you when you go on television? Are you ambassador? Are you yourself? Do you have your own ideas? Or do you have positions? And then into politics, which is maybe the hardest transition yet. Israeli politics are rambunctious. We are a flagrant democracy. It's the only word for it. In Knesset, it's not like the United States, where, you know, my distinguished colleague from South Carolina, from across the line. No, no, no. You egghead. You moron. If the seats in Knesset are not screwed down, we would throw them at one another. And then we all go out and have coffee. It's wonderful. Everyone holds hands outside the Knesset. It's a major transition. I have been living in Israel for close to 40 years. And I've done a lot. I thought I knew this country. When I got into Knesset, I realized I did not know it at all. We are a multi-partisan, we have the only legal communist party in the Middle East. We have 14 Arab members in Knesset. The deputy
secretary of the Knesset is an Arab. The CEO of the Knesset is a guy named Mohammed. And we're in there with Orthodox Jews and Druze and secular leftist Israelis, all in this 120-seat plenum. I'll just tell you two events that happened just before I got on the plane. I'll go on this book tour. I hosted Lindsey Graham, speaking of South Carolina, and he comes to Israel quite often. He's a foreign affairs guy. He's never been to the Knesset. So I took him to a debate in the plenary. And the debate was about homophobia in the healthcare system. And a Christian Arab woman gets up and talks about problems, homophobia in the healthcare system. A Druze man shouts at her. A leftist Israeli Jew shouts at the Druze. A rightist gets up and shouts. And we were supposed to be there for 2 minutes with Lindsey, and I couldn't get him to leave. This is the most fascinating thing I've ever seen in my life. Then we went to does that mean something, that 15? It means I got to shut up? Uh-huh.
No, we still have time to go.
So okay, good. I didn't know what that meant. I thought it was an Olympic score. I thought it was 15. Wow. And then we went to we don't have caucuses in Knesset because the word caucus in Hebrew means coconut. But we do have what's called lobbies, shtulot. And we had a lobby that was multi-partisan, left, right, up and down, in this room, just a little bit smaller than this room, 100 high school kids there, all wearing these red shirts, who were all transgender youth. And the issue was how to educate Israeli young people about the challenges of transgenderism in high school students. And one after another, these high school students got up and talked about their problems, and everyone's breaking out and crying. I'm serious. And there were two extraordinary things about this moment, I thought. One, that this discussion is taking place a two-hour drive from ISIS. Think about this. And the second extraordinary thing, which I think is even more extraordinary, was that I was the only person in that room who thought this was extraordinary. Everyone else was saying, of course we're having a discussion about educating young people about transgenderism. Of course we are. Why wouldn't we? We're in the Knesset. But me, I'm new. And I just think, wow, I can't believe this is happening. So I'm what can I say? I'm bowled away by this. That we have been able to maintain this democracy this way with all of the challenges is truly one of the great accomplishments of the State of Israel. That's it. 15.
So actually, in response to that, let me offer a quote from a political scientist I came across, Moaz Rosenthal. Israeli democracy is highly representative, but these institutions keep producing governments that can't govern.
Okay. That's a gotcha moment. You may, as Churchill famously said, or maybe infamously said, democracy is a terrible system of government, unless you compare it to all the other alternatives. And I can't point at just about any government, democratic system in the world which is not having governance issues. And when I was running for Knesset, very frequently, when you go from house to house and you have parlor meetings, people would say, we need a two-party system. And I would say, I've just come from 5 years in Washington. You may want to think about that again. All right? And strangely enough, it's true. The Knesset advances more legislation than just about any other parliament in the world, about 4,000 pieces of legislation per year. We pass one of the highest levels of enactment, but we're low on implementation, and we are low on maintaining governments. Governments are supposed to last 4 years. They almost invariably do not, and right now we're in the middle of a particular logjam because Israel now has, with one precedent, but not as problematic, during Rabin's first term in the 70s, we have the smallest majority of any government. It's 61 to 59, which is narrow as you get. And there have been votes, and I kid you not, where they give us a 10-minute bathroom break, and all of a sudden they come running into the bathroom, everybody out! The opposition's going to vote to take down the government. In some interesting states of undress as people were running back to the plenary. It's not very stable right now. It may change. And Prime Minister Netanyahu has kept certain seats in his government open in case someone wants to join the coalition and make it more stable. And it's true.
So this member of the audience wants to know, you mentioned that the Prime Minister has no power to stop settlement building.
In Jerusalem.
So how then can settlements be stopped to further the bridge to peace, this person asks?
Well, okay, this is a very good question, because we tried the moratorium, which was the freeze, the 10-month freeze. It was designed to get Mahmoud Abbas to come back to the table. He only came back to the table 3 weeks before the end of the freeze and demanded an extension of the freeze. And we all realized, the United States and Israel, that every negotiation would be about extending the freeze and not about the peace talks. I think we have to go back to an understanding that was reached between George Bush and Arik Sharon in 2004. It's called the Bush-Sharon letter. And what does it say? It says, we all know that there have been changes on the ground since 1967. There are now hundreds of thousands of Israelis who live beyond what was then called the 1949 armistice lines, now called the pre-67 lines. Let's not make a big deal out of it. We all know that the major Jewish neighborhoods of Jerusalem, in which over half the Jewish population of Jerusalem lives, plus the major settlement blocks, in which 85% of the settlers live, but only takes up 2% of the West Bank, we all know that's going to be part of Israel in the event of a two-state solution. Let's not make a big deal. Israel can build in these areas, and that will give Israelis space, because every once in a while we have to satisfy public opinion, and it will also give the Palestinians space, because we can build there, and the Palestinians are going to say, we're not going to walk away over the table on this. And if you looked at the leaked papers from the 2008 negotiations between Mahmoud Abbas and then Prime Minister Ehud Olmert, it shows that Mahmoud Abbas was not going to make a big deal about these areas. He understood that these areas would be part of Israel, and Israel would compensate the Palestinians in some way, the notion of swaps. But President Obama came into office in 2009, he disavowed that letter. He demanded total freeze, both in the blocks and in Jewish Jerusalem. And that created a problem for Israel, but it also created a problem for the Palestinians. Mahmoud Abbas gave an interview to the Washington Post where he said that the president put him up a tree and then kicked away a ladder, which was, up the tree, was the president of Palestine could not be less Palestinian than the president of the United States. So if Obama demanded total freeze in Jerusalem, so did Mahmoud Abbas, which meant every time Israel built something in an area which the prime minister had no authority to prevent, the peace process stopped. And this is what happened last April when Secretary of State Kerry's process failed. And you'll remember he testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, and he said that the Israelis built 700 units in a settlement, and the process went poof. Remember this? I spent 12 hours on Israeli television trying to find the Hebrew equivalent to the word poof. It doesn't exist. And but where did Israel build, which settlement did Israel build the 700 units in? By they didn't build them, they planned to build them. It was in Gilo. Gilo is a major neighborhood of Jewish Jerusalem. It was right across the street from where my kids grew up. My kids didn't think of Gilo as a settlement. Nobody in Israel thinks of Gilo as a settlement. But if you disavow the Bush-Sharon letter, then Gilo becomes a settlement. I think we have to go back to that letter. And I had the great privilege of designing the diplomatic platform for my party. It's the Kulanu Party. We're in the coalition, and our platform calls for return to the 2004 understanding that Israel should build only in those areas that will be part of a Jewish state should we ever reach a two-state solution. I don't think it's reachable right now. I think we should maintain that as our position. We should always be at the table, even though the chair opposite us is empty. But we should act in a way to prepare the ground for a two-state solution by not building in the middle of a future Palestinian state. That's it. Thank you.
So, of course, there are lots of questions from the audience that want to know variations on the theme of how much of the divide right now is personality between Obama and Netanyahu, and should Israel basically try to run out the clock on this administration?
I've heard the theory. I don't think we can afford to. By the way, a year and a half of presidency is a very long time. It's a long time in the Middle East. The entire Middle East changed in about 1 year in 2011. And I don't think we can afford, you know, to subscribe to that school. I think that we have to take measures now to try to restore some of those principles, understanding that the issue is not, it's not so much personal. You know, obviously this is not the relationship between Bill Clinton and Yitzhak Rabin. And it's not even the relationship between George Bush and Arik Sharon or Ehud Olmert. It's not that. We all get that already. Though I tell you publicly, behind closed doors, I never saw some of the fireworks that some of you saw outside closed doors. But there are fundamental divides. And I think the Iranian position, the Iranian issue, is a divide that's going to be very difficult to bridge. because of the structural differences that I mentioned, America the big country, Israel the little country, the ideological difference, the conceptual differences, Iran rational, irrational, these are very deep divides. And I think we have to, in order to be able to address the divides, we have to reestablish trust. And you cannot have a trust without reestablishing the notion of no surprises and no daylight. Those are the foundations of trust. And the last four pages of this book, which doesn't get a lot of attention in the media, is a prescription. I didn't want to leave my readers without a way forward. And I talk about how we have to move forward. From Israel, I recommend that Israel do the following. That whenever we make a decision, we have to take into account the ramifications of that decision on our relationship with the United States. We have to see the world occasionally through American eyes, and superpowers see the world differently than small regional powers. We have to take into account also the reaction of the American Jewish community. We have to be the nation state of the Jewish people in every way. We have to live up to our claim. But our relationship to the United States should be one that summarized in the following words. We should be saying to America all the time, thank you. Thank you. But every once in a while, we're going to have to say, thank you, but. Iran is a thank you, but moment. And the more we say thank you, the more we can say thank you, but. For the United States is also understanding that Israel is a sovereign country, respecting our sovereignty, respecting the choices of our population when we go to the ballot box. Many times I was told, especially during the Arab Spring, when the Arabs held elections briefly and they elected governments that weren't exactly to our liking, like the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, we were told by our American counterparts, you have to respect the people's choice. And I would say to them, how about our people's choice? And I call on the United States to respect our democracy more and cherish it, because it's truly a gem and an American asset. So read the four pages. It's a prescription, and it's hope.
So you've talked about how those four pages have not received much attention from the
media. But some other pages have.
That's the lead-in.
Right.
Firestorm, ruffled feathers. These are some of the words.
I came by this white hair, honestly. Earned it.
Has the reaction surprised you?
No. No, it hasn't. Listen, I touched on some very sensitive nerves. I set out, I can't understate this. This was a long process of deciding to write this book. I had reached it. The book comes from a deep place of caring, but also a deep place of concern, worry, and anguish. And it is a cri de cœur. It is that cry from the heart for everyone to stop, and all this bickering and some of the name calling. There was we were in Palo Alto, you know, someone in the White House called the Prime Minister chicken shit. I spent 12 hours on Israeli television trying to find the Hebrew equivalent to chicken shit. By the way, it doesn't work in Hebrew. Chicken shit, it doesn't go together, right? It doesn't work in Hebrew. There is no equivalent. Enough already. Really, really enough. We are squandering a precious alliance here, and in ways that do not redound to the interests of either country. So I touched raw nerves, and I set out not to hesitate. So whether it be talking about the ways in which I felt that the administration had eroded trust, the ways in which we eroded trust, very controversial. I came out against the Prime Minister's decision to speak before the both houses of Congress. In March. That wasn't an easy decision. I'd worked with him and worked with him very well. And talking about some of the very sensitive issues of Israel's relationship with American Jewry, Israel's relationship with the American press, Israel's relations with Jews in the American press, which is, for some audiences, some of the most incendiary parts of this entire book. I was not going to shy away from this, because this was my one chance to speak my heart. And just understand that I speak this heart from a place of love. It really is. And I understand it. Yes, it has ruffled some feathers, but if it starts the conversation, and I hope from looking at some of the talkbacks today that is happening, then it's worth another few gray hairs. Really it is. Thank you. Look at all those questions.
We could be here for about the next 3 days, I think, if we kept working on these questions. So I'm going to ask one serious question. We'll wrap up with one which will have a much shorter answer. But the serious question which follows on what you were just saying, so this person wants to know, what responsibility do both American and Israeli citizens have to help in trying to bridge the divide?
We have to understand one another's realities. And that sounds like almost platitudinous. But it is one of the greatest challenges I face as ambassadors. People used to ask me, what's harder, explaining America to Israelis or Israelis to Americans? Anybody want to guess? Turns out it's much harder to explain America to Israelis. Most Americans basically get Israel, you know, country, democracy, looks and walks, talks like us, under rocket fire, we get it. There's going to be differences over settlements. There's going to be differences on the Palestinian issue, but more or less get it. Israelis cannot figure out this place. Cannot figure out, you know, well, you know, when the Middle East unravels, Americans are all excited about democracy in the Middle East, and Israelis are going, oy gevalt, the whole place is falling apart. You have to explain this to them, that this is a Lexington and Concord moment for Americans. They don't get that. We come from profoundly different realities. And, you know, I was in another Knesset caucus, another Knesset lobby. We were discussing whether the Israeli government should give advantage, benefits to small industries in the neighborhoods around Gaza, Otef Gaza. And this seems like a black and white case. You know, of course we're going to give benefits. These people have been under shell fire for years. Why wouldn't we give benefits? Then all these NGOs show up, and they say, how do you define around Gaza? Turns out it's 7 kilometers from the Gaza border. What if I have a factory 7 kilometers and 3 meters from the Gaza border? Do I get the benefits? What about the people in Kiryat Shmona in the north? Do they get the same benefits? They're under rocket fire occasionally. And if we give them the benefits, how about the factory in Eilat? That can close down. And what about the man who has a factory 3 kilometers from Gaza, but he lives in Tel Aviv? Should he get the benefits? And I'm listening to this conversation, and it's a perfectly rational conversation between normal people in a totally surreal environment. We're talking about people under shell fire. Now, could you have that conversation in Palo Alto? It'd be nuts. Half the time I was writing this book, I'd have to run down to a bomb shelter because rockets were coming in. We are normal people in a totally abnormal environment. We have to translate that to an American population. But conversely, I have to translate an American reality to Israelis. And I'll give you just a small example for the American Jewry. If you say to American Jews, particularly of my generation, one word, Selma, that is packed with emotional meaning, emotional historic meaning. You say that to an Israeli, he thinks you're talking about his cousin in Long Island. Really. What does that mean, the American Jewish experience in the civil rights movement, and how profound that is for American Jews? Translating and getting each side to understand the other is one of the great challenges. And I take it on myself to try to meet it, but, you know, I hope others will join me in the effort. It is our historic duty.
So wrapping up with one quick question here. Early on as ambassador, you had an encounter with Mitch McConnell of Kentucky, who came to you with a complaint about Israeli tariffs on Kentucky bourbon.
Yes.
I wondered, you write, do Israelis even drink bourbon? So now that you're back in the Knesset.
I'm drinking bourbon.
All right.
Lots of bourbon. Yes, go ahead. Sorry, Steve.
That's the question. Do Israelis drink bourbon?
Israelis do not drink bourbon, and that was the first of two times. I recently met with McConnell's staff in Israel, and I told them that story. I expected, you know, McConnell, Republican leader, is very pro-Israel. My first meeting with him on the Hill, his staff walks in, he looks very dour at me. He says, your people are putting tariffs on my bourbon. And I looked at my aide. I said, do we drink bourbon? Is there a Hebrew word for bourbon? You know, bourbon? What is it? I've never heard of it. There's another great story about the congressman from Illinois who called me up and said, you are impounding, 70,000 pounds of frozen Illinois carp in the port of Ashdod, and was furious at me because he already had a 25% unemployment rate. And he complained to Secretary of State Clinton, who called a press conference. She said, you think making Middle East peace is hard? I'm dealing with carp. Netanyahu calls me up and says, what's all this crap about carp? And it goes on and on. This thing snowballs. And I'm trying to it turns out Israel has the first free trade agreement with the United States. It was signed by President Reagan. Now it's 30 years ago.
But there are certain exceptions. We protect avocados, we protect apples, apparently we protect bourbon, and we protect carp, because the Sea of Galilee, the farmers in the Galilee have all these ponds, they grow carp. So I, in a work of truly outstanding diplomacy, I begged on both my knees to the ministers of trade and finance, please let the carp enter the promised land. Just one time. And this all happened in April. And this congressman who wasn't Jewish called me up and he says, thank you. But I got one question. What do you Israelis do with all this carp? And I said, Congressman, we are approaching the holiday of Passover. On Passover, Jews eat gefilte fish. A gefilte fish is a delicacy that four iterations ago was a carp. And he actually asked me that. There are moments of humor in this book. You cannot make up.